Thank you, Drew. I'm excited to be here today. Is it not fantastic to live in the greatest state of the country, Georgia? It's a true honor for me to be here today. I was born just down the street here in Macon Hospital. I grew up in Warner Robins. I went to school in Georgia, raised my family here, ran businesses here. Georgia has always been my home. And now the greatest honor of my life has been to serve the people of Georgia in the United States Senate alongside Johnny Isaacson. He sends his regards today. He would be here, but you know the athlete he is. He's in rehab today and working from that athletic injury that he suffered a few weeks ago. In 2014, Bonnie and I decided to run for the United States Senate. We were very concerned about the direction of the country, and we felt like that somebody had to go that had some business experience to try to help change the direction of the country. We only had one message. It was pretty simple. Washington was broken. If you want different results, you got to send a different kind of person up there. And I can tell you, after 4.5 years as the outsider in the belly of the beast, let me tell you, Washington could learn a lot from this state of Georgia. I brag about our state legislature and our governors all over the country. Georgia's been named the best state in the country to do business for the 6th straight year, and that did not happen by accident. Many of you in this room deserve credit for that. We have a tax structure that encourages capital investment, a regulatory environment that allows for innovation and risk-taking. We have a state government that actually works, y'all. They do their job, they go home, and they live under the laws they wrote, and guess what? They fund the state government on time every year. Thanks to people like you and strong leadership at the state and local level, Georgia is truly open for business. And the Georgia Chamber plays a real role in it, a vital role in maintaining the vitality of the economy in the state of Georgia. And I want to personally thank Chris Clark and Sonny Dariso and Peter Carter for their steadfast leadership. Please help me thank them for their work with this chamber. After 8 years of the lowest economic growth in U.S. history, when President Trump was inaugurated, he said that job one was growing the economy. I was invited to the White House. It was for a meeting. This was 2 weeks after he was inaugurated. It was the president, the vice president, and me, and it was Mitch McConnell, John Cornyn from the Senate leadership in the Senate Republican caucus, and it was Paul Ryan, Kevin McCarthy, and Steve Scalise from the House. That was it. It was a really small group. We decided to focus on regulation, energy, taxes, and Dodd-Frank. And I can tell you that we so far have reversed over 2,000 regulations. We've unleashed our energy potential such that today we produce more oil and gas than any other country in the history of the world. We passed a historic tax bill that helps us become competitive with the rest of the world and also remove this onerous repatriation tax. We were the last country in the world to still have that. We repealed the most onerous parts of Dodd-Frank in a bipartisan effort that saved our community banks. We had lost 17,000 banks since Dodd-Frank became law of the land. We're now letting the free enterprise system work again, and as a result, we're now experiencing the greatest economic turnaround that I can find in U.S. history. We've created 6 million new jobs. We have the lowest unemployment in 50 years, actually the lowest African-American, Asian-American, and Hispanic unemployment ever measured. We have the highest median income, middle-class income, in the history of our country, but we're just getting started. In phase two, we agreed that we would work on immigration, trade, and infrastructure. The president, we well know now, has stood up to the rest of the world and is working to make sure that we also have an immigration system that allows us the organic growth in America to maintain this growth. We need workers in America to maintain this level of growth. This means changes to our legal immigration system. And I'm personally involved in this, and you will be hearing more from the president this fall about his platform to change our immigration laws to allow not only the protection of our country and our workers, but to allow for the input of more laborers into our labor force. In Georgia, with agriculture being over half of our economy, that's a major success factor as we go forward, and it could be a limiter on growth if we don't solve it. This also means investing in our historically black colleges and universities, our technical schools, and our apprenticeship programs. We've made this a priority at both the state and the federal level, and it's already making a huge difference right here in Georgia. And I want to take a second and just thank personally David Scott, U.S. Representative David Scott. He has been a long champion for our historically black colleges and universities, our land-grant universities here in Georgia. And I was so blessed to work with him over this last year or so as we put law into place to protect the benefits that the federal government had decided to give those universities over time. David, thank you. David has been a true leader in this effort, and I'm proud to call him a colleague in Washington. Who said that people on different sides couldn't work together? I mean, I went to Tech, but even I've learned how to say, go dog, so. Trading, that might have been harder than working with a Democrat, y'all, I'm sorry, but. Trade negotiations are always a difficult endeavor. And over the last seven decades, under both Republican and Democratic presidents, America has helped develop the rest of the world with our trade agreements. I personally think it was high time that somebody in leadership in the White House stood up for the American worker and American companies with our allies and our near-peer competitors. This renewed effort to increase trade has led to a new free trade agreement with South Korea. We have a USMCA that should be passed this year. Both sides should put pressure on Congress to vote that out. And ongoing negotiations with the European Union, with Japan, and Australia. People are now coming to the table asking us, let's start negotiations. We want a new free trade agreement. Tariffs are tough, I know. And anytime you get in a situation like this, both sides suffer for a while. But I agree with the objective long term of creating a level playing field with all of our trading partners around the world. Now, trade negotiations with China are particularly difficult. I've lived there, I've worked over there a good bit of my career, and this is not something that's going to happen very easily or very quickly. We're asking for five things. We're basically asking to stop stealing our technology, stop forcing the transfer of technology into the joint ventures over there, to comply with the World Trade Organization rules, to stop the cyber war, and give us equal access. Now, most of us think about trade as just the equal access part, but these other parts are very major complements or components of this negotiation. I was over there last year, and as a matter of fact, I'm going back over there over Labor Day to have substantive conversation with senior leaders in Beijing about this conversation and to back up the president's effort to make sure those people know we're serious and that we've got to have progress. I'm confident that we will, but I'm also here to say this could be a long-term process. I'm hopeful that we'll get some short-term equal access. That's the most important thing. And I'm delighted to see that the president has delayed some of the tariffs that we've been talking about just today, as a matter of fact. With regard to infrastructure, here in Georgia, we have a perfect example of the type of infrastructure project that really makes sense. It has a return on investment. The Savannah port, for over 20 years, we've been trying to deepen that port, just 5 feet, 5 feet. When I told that to the president, I explained to him when we were in that same conversation 2 weeks after he was inaugurated, we talked about you have a poster child in Georgia. If you want to talk about infrastructure, we don't need to wait 2 years to talk about that. We can talk about that right now. We've been trying to deepen it 20 years. He couldn't believe that. But because of Secretary Chao, who you'll meet later, and President Trump, I am proud to tell you that we now are looking at the third straight year of full funding for the Port of Savannah, and we're looking for completion by 2022. And the best news is yet to come. This is what happens when the federal government can stimulate growth. What happens is the private sector begins to take over, and management of that port, being an authority, is led by people from the industry. These are experienced people. They know what they're doing. And they're telling me that they're going to potentially double the capacity of that port. That means demand is going to double over the next 5 to 10 years. And guess what? They're going to do that out of cash flow. No federal dollars, no private dollars, no state dollars. This is going to be done out of cash flow from operations. I think that is fundamentally remarkable, and it's a model that we can replicate around the country. Since World War II, the world has experienced the greatest economic boom in the history of humankind. We've all enjoyed the benefits of that. The United States undoubtedly has led this effort while rebuilding Europe and Asia through the Marshall Plan after World War II and continued to help to develop the Third World with our trade rules, our trade agreements. These people didn't take advantage of us, as some say. We basically wrote the rules for a purpose, and that was to raise up the Third World, and we've done that. Over the last 60 years, because of this, global serious poverty has been reduced by about 60%. This dramatic growth in America was based on innovation, capital formation, and the rule of law, on the back of what I would argue is the best workforce in the history of the world. And we're now setting ourselves up for even a better period of continued growth, if we so choose. The problem, because of extremism in our political process, we may choose not to do that. Make no mistake, today in America, the free enterprise system is under attack. If you participate in the free enterprise system, and I hope you do, or otherwise I wonder why you're here, this is the Chamber of Commerce. If you participate in the system, I think that you have to pay attention. We all have to pay attention. We cannot sit by and watch the development of a central government managed economy. We've seen that around the world, and it's failed every time. I've worked under these conditions in other countries. Trust me, if we don't stand up now for the free enterprise system, we're going to lose the ability to do the things that we really need to do. We have to have a safety net. But when you're borrowing money to pay for the safety net, that's not sustainable long term. But that's what's at stake here. Whatever your political persuasion, I'm asking you today to rise above any issues that may be a single issue for you and think about the important fundamental reason how this country has prospered for 230 years. In America today, we're proving that what the founding mothers and the founding fathers had in mind really does work. Economic opportunity for everybody, fiscal responsibility, limited government, and yes, individual liberty. When you give power to the central government, the place that the pressure comes from is that you lose individual liberties. We've seen that just in the last 100 years in America. The closing sentence of the Declaration of Independence is very telling. These people were serious. Had they failed, they would have been hung as traitors. And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, our sacred honor. You and I need to stand together today in the same sense of urgency, with the same sense of dedication to each other, not to a political party, but to each other. And tell the world that we will never let anyone threaten the free enterprise system right here in America. God bless you. Thank you for what you're doing for Georgia. And God bless Georgia. And God bless the United States of America. Thank you. Thank you. Now I have the high honor today of introducing a very special friend of mine. And she's no stranger to the state of Georgia either. Remember when the I-85 bridge burned? Now, I didn't know concrete could burn, but we proved it could here in Georgia. When the I-85 bridge actually collapsed during rush hour in the middle of in Atlanta in 2017, this is early in her responsibility as Secretary of Transportation. Secretary of Transportation Elaine Chao happened to be in Canada that day with Rob Woodall. Along with President Trump, she jumped into the breach and went into action right away. She removed all regulatory impediments and immediately got funds flowing for the reconstruction project here in Georgia. I was personally involved with her. She called daily talking about updates. She made sure that anytime we had any kind of federal slowdown in anything, she removed it. Because of her efforts singularly, along with those of state and local officials, that bridge was built, and listen to this, in 43 days. An entire month ahead of schedule, as she just reminded me, and yeah, David, it was under budget too. How's that for getting things done as a Secretary of Transportation? Thank you. As we go forward, I am absolutely convinced that we're going to create the transportation in this country will become something truly spectacular because we have a Secretary of Transportation that is truly spectacular. Secretary Elaine Chao knows how to get the job done. She's been trained in the public sector and the private sector, and throughout her career, she's been able to demonstrate a clear ability to solve problems and save taxpayer dollars. That's what Secretary Chao did for us in Georgia, and that's what she will continue to do as the administration works to rebuild the infrastructure here in America. But as Secretary of Transportation, this is her second cabinet position. In 2001, 2009, she was Secretary of Labor and actually was the first Asian-American woman ever to be nominated and confirmed as a cabinet member in the history of the United States of America. I think that's remarkable. It gets better. Besides having a Harvard MBA, she has 37 honorary doctorate degrees. I don't even know how you do that. I mean, when I was at Georgia Tech, I was trying to get an honorary bachelor's degree. 37. Sometime I'm going to ask her how she did that. But I would say that she's my favorite cabinet member today. But we all know how Sonny can pout. But that's okay, because there's a certain Kentucky senator that might really pout if Secretary Chao called me her favorite senator in the United States Senate. But with that, it's my high honor today to introduce to you the United States Secretary of Transportation, Elaine Chao.